It sounds like a live recording.
Like all the quirky things you get from a band, you get from this recording.
It's so unorthodox, I just thought, like, how can I capture it?
Hello and welcome back to Dead Wax.
Today we are listening to Dave Matthews Band, Ants Marching. Let's jump right in.
That brings me back.
All the way back.
All the way back.
They're like one of the few bands where even...
I mean, stop right there. Literally, they're one of the few bands.
Yes, like... exactly. I was just going to say, there's no studio version of their records. It's all live. Like, it even sounds like he's singing into a 58. Like,
he is singing in a 58.
This is John Alagía. He's a record producer, engineer, and mixer. He's worked with artists like John Mayer, Dave Matthews Band, Jason Mraz, and so many more. Is he singing into a 58?
Yes, he is.
It sounds like a 58.
Yeah. A 58, short for a Shure SM58, is kind of the most common vocal mic. Think about when you see a band on stage. Most often, they're using a 58. It can be used for other things as well, but it is so popular because it's a dynamic microphone, meaning it has a really tight pickup pattern. So it's not going to pick up all the things happening around it, but mostly focus on just what's right in front of it.
Yeah.
And so he does that on purpose? He likes that live sound?
I think that was recorded. I mean, Steve Lillywhite produced that version, but they were at Bearsville up in New York, upstate New York, and I think he just sung it in the control room. I mean, I'm almost certain of that.
Like, through just a 58 in the control room.
Yeah, with the speakers kind of blasting, so you get more of the energy.
That's
yeah.
what it sounds like to me.
Yeah.
It sounds like a live recording, and they're yeah. one of the few bands that makes records that sound live.
Yeah, this, I feel like, I mean, this is what, 25 years ago?
1994.
Oh my God, almost 30 yeah. years ago. There were more bands then. Now, bands are more of an anomaly. But back then, I mean, this is like Nirvana, Ben Folds 5.
Yep.
You still had bands on record labels that yeah. still sold records. But still, comparing this to something like, you know, John Mayer or something that used like session musicians at the time, this, you hear, like, all the quirky things you get from a band, you get from this recording. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The instrumentation is strange, to say the least. Carter Beauford's drumming is...
remarkable.
...is so unique.
Yeah.
I mean, what an iconic hi-hat flavor this is.
Incredible.
And those little yeah. splash cymbals.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
You did not produce this song.
No, but I produced a version of that before that version, and it was a hybrid of a live recording, and then we did some overdubs on top of it. And it's funny because this version, I mean, I recorded so many versions live with them with different tempos, I mean, this is a really good tempo because this is where they are for the most part in their live recordings. But yeah, they're just a remarkable band. I mean, you would think, I mean, even back like in 1994. You would think you could set these guys up in a room and just press go and do it. But I think that the band really wanted to be kind of dissected and kind of like looked at, you know, under a microscope and really kind of refine themselves. And Carter, when he's recorded, he always kind of pulls himself back a little bit. Because if you see him live, he's like animal, you know, he's crazy in yeah. a really beautiful way. But on their studio recordings, they do like to, like, they'll go in and they'll play together, but then they'll go back and, like, they'll put their layers on top of, like, the bass and drums.
Interesting.
You know?
Oh, really? Is that
yeah,
what they did
much.
For this, too?
Yeah.
No it, way.
It,
that's
it was,
so funny.
It was, like, bass and drums, and then they do, I mean, they'd all play live, but they would just for, like, tonal purposes, like, they'd, you know, have, like, recut some acoustics, you know, and then kind of refine the violin and sax. I mean...
That's so interesting because it sounds tracked all at once.
A lot of those records sound like that, but there are a lot of them, you know,
are overdubs.
Yeah.
To me, one of the most iconic things about this song is the first 5 seconds. Just like the empty snare drum. And how that kind of sets you up to think you have no reference for what is this time? Is this snare happening on downbeats? Is it? And then the rest of the stuff comes in. And you realize you've been had because that's 2 and 4 that you've been listening to.
But then the
it
snare comes out
right.
for the backbeats.
Right.
And is only on the first two. And it's such an odd choice. Like, you'd think that would
keep going.
You'd think it would keep going, and instead the kick happens without the snare, and it's immediately.
And you know why I think that works? Is the busyness of the hi-hat.
And the guitar line is really busy, because it's like, it's so unorthodox, and Dave is a master at his unorthodox guitar, and you got to kind of keep some space. So I think Carter listens very closely to what's going on in the guitar.
Interesting. So they can we play that when the snare goes out?
Yeah.
And hear what the guitar is doing? That's a great point, is the snare being gone there puts the focus on that guitar line.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
This to me sounds like a song written by a band that plays live all the time.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because it's exactly what you want to play coming on stage to friggin' 20,000 people or whatever. It's just, it feels crafted for that moment.
They've refrained on recording anything for anyone for a long time. Like they began as a band in December of 1991. I met them in April of 1992, and I started. They would let me record with my multi-track, so I'd bring my little 16-track multi and record their shows. But they were like, "We're not going to release this." But they would also just release the board tapes, which just where we get out. But they didn't want to have anything out there. They wanted to like really refine their sound and get it together before they put anything out. And I didn't really understand it, but. Now I do.
How pivotal to the resurgence of like this whole jam band thing that came back with them. Was that their doing, or like it was them
blues,
plus Fish plus
and Blues Traveler.
Blues
Traveler helped these guys out tremendously. They take them out on the road and open up tours with them.
They really built their thing like grassroots.
And they, you know, like we're talking about the emergence of John Mayer and you know, his trajectory. Dave's was pretty much the same way. Like by 1994, he was playing, sheds and arenas.
Can you talk about the way that he sings?
I mean, he's not trained.
Yeah.
In any way, and he didn't start playing guitar until he's 23. I mean, that record was made when he was 27, I guess.
Wow.
And that's bonkers.
Was he not like writing and singing before 23?
He started doing that, and he just kind of picked it up, and it's.
To me, though, this is the 90s vocal style. This is the Eddie Vedder. It's that kind of, it's, you know what I mean? Like, that was a vocal creed, right? Yeah, it's like there's a bunch of bands whose lead vocalist had that kind of thing.
I never put that together. That's funny.
You know, also, it was the day and an age.
Also, this is like the age of white guys rapping, like the bare naked ladies. What was that?
Oh, hold it now and watch the hood wink. Let's stop. Think. You think of looking at Aquaman. I can do that whole rap. I won't do it. I will spare you
now. That was a thing. Yeah. People were doing at the time.
Yeah.
It was all kind of like influencing each other, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You made an interesting point though about about it being a band. One of the things that I think is, you know, makes it feel like that is it's not like they're using sonic textures and timbral landscapes for production in this recording.
Right.
It's hits or solos or trading solos.
Yep.
Or now we're gonna do violin and sax dueling. Those are the production moments that add new flavors.
Yeah.
But the sonic timbre and textures stay the same the entire way through.
Right. It's also like the violin and the sax are playing the whole time, which is very rare. We look at each other, wondering what if you gave us this band, we wouldn't necessarily have everyone playing the entire time.
Right.
But it results in a cool, you know, mixture of sounds.
It's a
unit.
It's a unit. It's a vibe. Yeah.
I remember early days, I was trying to have some label, or I sent this around to a few labels and met with people, and they just said, "No way." I said, "We're not going to touch a fiddle. We're not going to touch a saxophone, and those two guys at the same time. That ain't."
Two wrongs?
I love that.
Two wrongs make a right. With like, how does that work? How does this work?
Yeah.
The fiddle plus the sax.
Yeah.
But look at DMB and look at Fish. It's like, I don't know. I think what I love about these acts, and I mean, I think Fish too. You know, they're one of the biggest bands in the world. They have their own streaming service.
Yeah.
You know, like they throw their own festivals.
Yeah.
Like, who can do that? who's been making music for like 30 years, you know, and there are a couple bands like this, like Dave, you know, who have this rabid fan base, who can throw these shows, who can do these festivals. And it's the outlier stuff that I think very few labels are going to say, yeah, we're going to do that. But it finds an amazing community.
But the thing that's a little surprising to me about labels saying hell no is that this is substantive. Like, this is a good song.
Yeah.
This has a good melody and hooks everywhere and an A section and a B section. And like, you know, it stays interesting throughout the whole thing. There's the hits and the breakdown moment. It's sort of like an adaptation of a live thing in a way that substantively works as a recording. Can we zoom out and back up for a second? I'm just curious, your evolution from like as a producer, from where you started to meeting Dave. Can you fill in that gap for me? Like, how did you guys meet and where? Yeah. What had you done before that?
I was working with all these bands in the Mid-Atlantic. And
you grew up where?
I was in Kentucky, but I also had a place. Well, I went to school in D.C., and then I had a little house in a recording studio in Northern Virginia. I brought a band down to Ardent Studios in Memphis called Kevin Johnson and the Lyman, and I did 5 days with them, and we made a really cool record.
Okay.
Dave Matthews had been at that studio probably 3 months prior, and so Dave's management called that studio saying, hey, we're looking for a young producer to work with. Mm-hmm. And Ardent Studios said, work with this guy because he just came down here and he did a really good job. So in that same 24 hours, I was talking to my friend Scott Clayton, who's John Mayer's and a bunch of other folks' agent. He told me to go down to the Bayou in Washington, D.C. and check out Dave Matthews.
So you saw him live.
Within that 24-hour period, both things wow. had happened. And then Dave and I met. I mean, it was...
How old were you at the time?
I was 26, I guess, 27.
Crazy.
But when I saw that band live, it was like love at first sight. I just thought, like, how am I going to make this? How can I capture this?
And where did you come from musically? Like, what were your favorite records growing up?
Oh, I mean...
What made you want to be a producer?
I'd always been putting music together on, like, you know, 2 tracks, 4 tracks, 8 tracks. And, I mean, I dissected the Beatles when I was young. And I love the Beatles. I still do.
Wait, I have to ask you about that. When you say you dissected the Beatles.
Well, just trying to, like, you know, when I was a young kid, trying to, like, replay, you know, any record, trying to, you know, do the drums, bass, guitars, trying to redo, like,
all those instruments yourself?
Yeah.
So on a 2-track to try to recreate the Beatles.
So you would, like, re-record. You basically trained yourself to be a producer. You did your own ear training. You were listening for individual parts and then recording them back to see if you could get it to sound like that.
Exactly.
So I do that too.
Yeah, it was a really great exercise. And also when you're young, I mean, you have all the time in the world. You can just kind of, like, spend all your days and weeks and months in your basement doing that kind of thing. But I would just record those things. I had a bunch of bands. I had a buddy of mine named Doug Derryberry, and we had a little band for a while. I was always in bands.
What was that called?
Derryberry and Alagía.
Very clever.
He's one of my best. He's a badass too. Ben.
Did he fight you to put his name first, or
most likely? Okay. He was younger too. I don't know why that happened, but he got his way. But anyways, we ended up like every penny we made as a band, we would throw into recording gear. And so we had a pretty cool little recording studio in our basement. And we started working with, you know, like Vertical Horizon, Edwin McCain. I had Ben Folds in there and just like all these bands in the Mid-Atlantic. And we were making good little recordings in there. And then Dave Matthews heard about it. And so that it all kind of led up to working with Dave.
So you were, I mean, it sounds like the fact that you had a little home studio in the, what, 80s?
In the 80s.
Like late 80s?
Mm-hmm. What were you tracking on?
We first started with a 4-track, and then we went to an 8-track, which was fantastic. Then we went to a 16-track half inch. Everything was done. Yeah, but we learned how to submix things really quickly.
Uh-huh.
So we made a lot of records on 8-track half inch. Then when we got the 16-track, we felt like you know, we're
who needs more than 16 tracks?
Yeah, we're 16. And then we go to other studios and work on 24 tracks. And then ADATS came around, which was 1993, and I did Dave Matthews' first independent record on ADAT. Then DA88s. We just kind of kept on chasing the technology.
Yeah.
So you produced Dave before this record.
Yes.
You produced Dave a lot after this record.
Mm-hmm.
Was it weird when he said, hey, John, we're going to get this other guy to...
Not at all.
Like, how did that, what was that like?
I was with Dave. We were driving around the Virginia countryside, and we were listening to a whole bunch of records, because I didn't really think of myself as a producer.
Right.
I mean, I was more a musician, and I thought, and I was kind of like so nervous and terrified of that band because they were so good that I thought they needed a real proper engineer. So we brought in, they brought in T-Bone Burnett, and T-Bone was wonderful.
Did T-Bone engineer that record?
No, but T-Bone was, he was interviewed. They interviewed a whole bunch of folks and then—
To produce the record.
To produce the record.
Did T-Bone turn them down, or did they turn down T-Bone?
No, they chose Steve Lillywhite. And Lillywhite was ideal for this band, because when you have an English accent, you can get away with pretty much anything.
That's right.
And he's really good with people. And he knows how to make a really cool record. He made so many great records. So when it came to the choice of the producer, the band had heard a bunch of his records. Dave and I would drive around the countryside and we'd listen to XTC, you know, Susie and the Banshees, just all these records that Steve Lillywhite made. And I just thought, that guy's the guy.
This was an opportunity as a young producer for you to see a guy who made a bunch of records you loved, to kind of watch him in action.
Yeah, so I became friends with Steve and I watched him during that whole thing, and I just, his process, he was so lighthearted about it all. And like he was just fun, and there was no labor to it whatsoever.
Yes.
And so like the whole vibe was amazing. Whereas I think I took myself a little too seriously early on, and I, you know, because you want to be in control of everything. That's not the point.
But did he give like critical feedback? Was he able to say like, hey, let's do another take?
Yeah, I think he just wanted it to be, he knew the band was great and he would just like let them do their thing, and then he would edit. He's a remarkable editor. Mm. I mean, one time he would take out a, you know, 2-inch piece of tape and he'd say, we don't need that drum fill. So he'd cut a little diamond in the middle of that 2-inch tape and say, see, there's no more drum fill. And like, it just, the guy was just a genius at cutting tape.
Wow.
So he would just take the best of all their elements, and he'd also run things through like the Eventide DSP 4000 and the harmonizer. He just knew how to do a lot of really cool things. Like, he'd like manipulate sounds. Mm-hmm. And it really worked well for that band. I mean, that was a great little combination.
What's Dave like to work with?
He's one of my best buddies. I love him. He's great.
Is he a perfectionist?
He is.
Are you a perfectionist?
Yeah. But he's, I think, you know, you just want to always do well, and you sometimes overthink things, but you just have to like step back. I mean, that's the most important part, is just like not making sure you over, I mean, it's so easy to overthink and overanalyze things.
Yeah.
You know? But he's the best. Yeah. He's easy. He's funny as hell. Like, I mean, time goes by very quickly when you're hanging out with that guy.
And do they still make records like that now? Does the band still get in a room, they track the instruments to basically bass and drums, and then they re-record everything
else?
Yeah,
I mean, during COVID, because of COVID, they had to go in and do like drums. Mm. You know, then they put their gloves on and go do bass, and then, you know, everyone had to do their different stations because it was COVID. You couldn't be in a room at the same time.
Yeah.
But I'm sure there have been records where these guys have all been up in a room together and have recorded. But I think a lot of bands also, there's, you know, I'm sure you guys have been in rooms where you just see everything is, it's you want it to all be recorded. I mean, at the same time, I think that's the best thing in the world is to have it all recorded at one time.
Yeah.
Because it's all, there's all the glue there.
Right.
You know?
You've seen 8 tracks, 16 tracks, half inch, ADAT, Radar, Pro Tools. You've seen a lot of new technology. What do you think about modern recording technology?
How old are you?
I'm old.
Like when you hear records today, what's your reaction? Like, are you excited about modern music and modern production techniques?
I mean, some things for sure. It all depends on who's driving, you know? Like, I love the Harry Styles stuff. I love Emily King's.
Oh, yeah. Emily King's so good.
I mean, there's so many things that you can do with modern technology I mean, I love it. I mean, I love Pro Tools. I know a little bit about Logic, and I know not enough about Ableton, but I think it's all good for
what her. Was it about Dave Matthews Band that you felt like, I want to work with these guys?
I mean, I walked in on a song called Satellite. I watched his fingers, and I watched him singing. I heard the melody, and I heard the lyric. And I'm like, I'm so in.
Yeah.
And then I heard everything else. I was completely sold in a matter of like a minute.
You're a very humble man. In what ways did you work with them in their evolution? Like, what Can you talk about like how you might have brought them along or shepherded these records like into creation or what you contributed? Because I know you didn't just stand there.
Well, I do think that I was just a little helper, like in trying to like capture them live, you know. And then I had it. I mean, we found a really good producer, Steve Lillywhite, to kind of carry on. And then I would just kind of go in between those record cycles. I'd go in with Dave, and we would just work on songs together. I would be with him, you know, one on one for 2 or 3 months at a time at his house in Virginia, and I was just his sounding board, mm-hmm. and he needed someone to kind of react to. And if I would be like, that's a good one, you know, like let's chase that and let's go there. That was kind of my job, and then I would do like little recordings with him. We would make really cool pre-production recordings, and they'll get released sometime, because some of those things I think almost they can rival some of the things that were released, and Dave would say the same thing.
When you work with artists, are you like, you know, different producers have different approaches here. Mm-hmm. Do you kind of feel like it's all fair game? Lyrics, melody, harmony, groove, sonic textures. Do you push on everything with the artist, or do you? Yeah, what's your approach when you're working with artists in general?
I think everything changes. Mm-hmm. And even before I walk into a room with people, I think I got to get to know them a little bit. I can't go into a cold thing and say, "Here, let's make music." I want to hang out with them and make sure that there's like enough vibe and rapport and trust, like, because I don't want to get into a room and just fight with someone the whole time. Mm-hmm. I got to really be on board with what they're doing, and just I got to love them, like just what their whole being is, kind mm-hmm. of, and then we can get into it. And then, you know, I think when you start from scratch, you just kind of feed off each other, and you talk about your influences. You talk about like, you know, what way makes sense. And sometimes what I'll do is I'll just throw a lot of things at the board and see what people like. And that's one way I've done it in my life. Like, you know, like you throw a whole lot of things. There are certain artists that, you know, if you have that, the resources, you can go in with like a few different rhythm sections, you know, which is, it's rare when that happens, but
rare to have resources.
Yeah, it's rare to have resources. So, or sometimes you're just doing this, you know, on your keyboard,
right?
You know, making grooves, which is, I feel like I'm too. I miss that bit. I mean, I still do it, but I much rather have a real drummer. I like to have real people all the time.
Yeah, you know, it definitely helps.
But yeah, so I think you just kind of like, for me, it's you throw a whole kitchen sink in and it just slowly remove things. You know, when I have a band, I love having a band. Mm. I got to work with Lucas Nelson and his band, and that was just having more people under one roof at the same time is the best.
What's your favorite Dave record that you've worked on?
I like Busta stuff a lot.
Yeah, I love that record.
I also like Groo Rex King. I don't know if you've heard that one.
No, I don't know that I have.
It's got teeth.
Can I also ask you, since, I mean, you've made so many records with so many great people, Dave aside, Mayor aside, career highlights, like if you met someone and you can only play them one or two records that you've been done aside from those guys, what are you most proud of?
I'm very proud of my Rachel Yamagata work.
Yeah.
And a lot of people don't know who she is, but I love her.
Yeah,
and I think the first record we made was really, a lot of people think it's the best thing I ever worked on. I loved working on that record. Mm-hmm. And we butted heads.
Really?
We butted heads every record.
How so?
I made 5.5 records with her, and we would just, because she would always want to be, Rachel, if you see this, this is all coming from love.
Oh, yeah. We're not releasing any of this, by the way.
Oh, okay. No, but it's just like, she would always want, she would go dirge. You know, like she would like just, it'd be so slow.
Uh-huh. And so you'd argue over tempo?
Tempo, and then I'd also argue over form. We'd get into it about the instrumentation. But it was great. It was a great back and forth. And ultimately, where it went was good, I think.
Yeah. You
know? I feel like those conflicts are so healthy.
They are healthy.
Some of the best music I've ever produced and or just been a part of producing has been when those moments have existed, when my tendency or inclination was to go hard this way and somebody was like, this way, and they tame certain parts of me that are, you know, not nice, and I'm bringing them into something that's a bit more interesting or whatever. And then we meet in this wonderful place. I feel like Pomplamoose is very much like that. I'm, you know, without Natalie, I get into screamo land pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. And then like when we add her there, it's just, it's something that I would have never done without her.
Yeah.
Yeah, so those, I love those conflicts.
Yeah, conflict is good in a lot of situations, for sure.
What do you got, Ryan? You start for
us. I just listened to the new Diana Ross Tame Impala song for the, I think it's a Minions soundtrack.
So good.
Turn Up the Sunshine.
Love that.
It's really
track.
Good.
It's so good.
I don't know what the people behind the Minions are doing. We were talking about this, like what buzzwords they're giving these
because
writers.
Because I'm happy. The Pharrell song. The Pharrell song. Was also from the Minions.
Which is great. Anyways, I really like that song, and I love that Diana Ross and Tame Impala made something together.
So killing.
Yeah.
What do you got for us?
I am crazy for Harry Styles. Like any record, this Golden, I'm crazy for that song. You're so golden.
He's so good.
He's remarkable. They made such great records. They're great sounding records. The instrumentation, just every at the production, the writing, it's all top notch to me.
Yeah, agreed. What do you got, Jack?
I discovered this band late. I don't know how I missed it in the early 2010s, but the band is Real Estate.
Oh. Mm.
And there's a record, a song called Friday. Which opens this record that I listen to over and over and over. And
anyone who says that a band name has to be Googleable, Real Estate.
Yeah, give me a break.
Yeah.
But man, this band, this track in particular draws from some like Air influences, you know, late 90s, early 2000s. And it's just that there's this ride cymbal that just goes over the whole thing. It's beautiful. And yeah, it's sunset music. It's so nice. I love it.
John, you are such a treasure, man.
Thank you so much for doing this with us. Thank you very much for letting me be here.
You're a legend. I could talk to you about music all day. Thank you guys so much for watching. This has been Dead Wax. If you like what you've seen here, leave a comment. Smash that like. Subscribe. We'll see you next week.
Bye, everybody.